Okay, so hi everyone, welcome to today's book launch and a very special screening in celebration of Manchester Pride Weekend. My name is Dot and I work as the curator at Easing Contemporary. We are the UK's only non-profit art organization specializing in presenting and platforming artists and art practices that identify with and are informed by East and Southeast Asian cultural backgrounds. So first of all, we're very delighted to host book launch of Contemporary Queer Chinese Art by Dr. Hongwei Bao. And it's being very published very recently by Bloomsbury Publishing in June. And so the book, Contemporary Queer Chinese Art, is the first English language academic book that explores the intersections of queer culture and contemporary Chinese art from the mid-1980s to the present. This book brings together 15 internationally renowned artists, activists, curators, and scholars to explore heterogeneous expressions of Chineseness and queerness in contemporary art from China and Chinese diasporas in Asia, Europe, and North America. And tonight we have one of the contributing artists in Burong joining the conversation and talk with Hongwei. So following the talk, there will be a chance for you to ask any questions you might have, and also a quick break where you can enjoy the refreshments on the kitchen counter, help yourself, and following that we will have the special screening, and I will be able to tell more details before the screening. So I'm just going to briefly introduce the two speakers for the first half of the event. So Dr. Hongwei Bao is the Associate Professor in Media Studies at the University of Nottingham. He was firstly trained as a cultural historian. He has published 4 books on Chinese queer histories and culture, namely Queer Comrades, Gay Identity and Tongzhi Activism in Post-Socialist China, Queer China, Lesbian and Gay Literature and Visual Culture under Post-Socialism, Queer Media in China, and Contemporary Chinese Queer Performance. He's a co-editor of Contemporary Queer China Chinese Art and the Routledge Handbook of Chinese Gender and Sexuality. He co-edits 2 book series. One is titled Oyster, Feminist and Queer Approaches to Arts, Cultures and Genders, and the other one is titled Queer in China, Transnational Genders and Sexualities. Besides being an academic, he's also a creative writer. His poetry, essays and short stories have appeared in Cha, an Asian literature journal, Modern Chinese Literature and Culture, Positions Politics, Shanghai Literature Review, the Autoethnographer, the Sociological Review, Voice and Verse, Write On and Words Without Borders. His short story was shortlisted for the Plata Prize for Sudden Fiction in 2023. And then we also have in the room with us Burong. So Burong Zhen, she they is a live art practitioner, researcher with a doctorate in performance studies and art producer. Zen is deeply interested in the lived experience of the invisible disability and its effect on the meaning-making and performance-making process, particularly for diaspora and newer queer artists. Zen's recent performance explores how sticky and vicious materials can disrupt binary thinking and broaden our perspective of embodiment, otherness, body politics, and non-human agency. So, I just want to very lastly do a few quick notes on the logistics. So the fire exit, you can find it on the left to the kitchen counter, and the toilets are available when you walk out the room through the back door. If you have any questions, you can ask any staffs in the room. You can find us, identify us with the yellow badge, and we will also be taking photos and videos to be used for our upcoming marketing purpose. So if you prefer not to appear in any media, please do let us know. And yes, we hope that you enjoy today's event.
Okay, so thank Dot for your very kind introduction, and thank EC Contemporary for hosting this book launch. So this afternoon's book launch actually has two parts. The first hour, we're going to talk about the book, and then followed by a documentary, a screening of a recent documentary. When I say recent, it was actually only made last month, and it is probably the UK screening of that documentary. So our documentary filmmaker, as well as a project co-director, will come here to share with you, actually, the documentary processes and the project and so on. So in the first half, Burong and I will talk about the book. So my major task is to introduce the kind of origin of the book as well as background of the book. So for those who are probably not so familiar with Chinese queer culture, so I'm a kind of queer historian writing about contemporary Chinese queer culture from the 1990s to present. So compared to, for example, British queer culture and history, this has a much shorter history, but it's very intensive because in the 1990s, we witnessed actually the emergence of queer NGOs and movements at the same time, a lot of HIV/AIDS initiatives. And then in 1997 marked the decriminalization of homosexuality in Chinese law. And after that, a lot of queer spaces appeared in Chinese cities. And of course, before that, there were a lot of queer spaces, but they were very hidden and underground. And after that, there were more and more visible queer spaces and queer organizations appearing in Chinese cities. So the process wasn't that straightforward. So I'll give you some ideas. So when I was doing my PhD in the 2009-ish, so there were about queer organizations or NGO, non-governmental organization, or charities in every Chinese city. There were about 200 queer NGOs. And now in China, there were almost zero queer NGOs. This was because of many reasons, but one of the reasons was a kind of the recent Chinese government's crackdown on LGBTQ activism, and also the censorship of LGBT issues in Chinese media as well as in Chinese films, etc. For example, if you Google homosexuality or LGBT whatever on Chinese version of the Google, and you probably can't get much results. And only recently, actually, I think a couple of weeks ago, lots of what major LGBT NGOs WeChat account, or WeChat is probably like the Facebook version of Chinese Twitter, so it was shut down by the Chinese government. So, and this was significant, and this kind of decline only happened in the past, well, I would say in the past 5 years, 7 years, or 8 years. And so we were witnessing actually a difficult struggles of LGBTQ people in China. Not only were their rights not recognized by law and by society, but they were, in a way, active, in a way, crackdown on LGBTQ organizations. So this is, of course, a historical background of my talk and the book. So the two pictures that I'm showing here, the first one is Shanghai Pride in 2020. In 2020, and everybody was saying how great it was actually to be able to hold Shanghai Pride during the pandemic. But of course, I mean, when they were taking the Pride, little was known that this would be the last Pride in Shanghai and the last biggest Pride in China. So now there were no such Pride available in Chinese cities. And then the picture on the right-hand side was a closure of Beijing LGBT Center earlier this year. I visited Beijing LGBT Center about 7 years ago, 8 years ago, 10 years ago. They were an important community hub, but their activities are not possible today. So at this backdrop, in the past 20 to 30 years, we saw the kind of unstable development of China's queer community, identity, and activism. We also saw a kind of booming of queer cultural productions, such as art, literature, cinema, and so on. So a lot of them may not be explicitly identified as queer or LGBT. However, they do exist, and there are many queer identifying or non-identifying people who are producing artworks that celebrate same-sex intimacy. Some of those artworks probably use ancient Chinese or traditional Chinese art forms, such as paper cutting. So the picture on the left-hand side is a paper cutting artwork by Xi Yadie. Xi Yadie comes from rural China, and he learned the paper cutting actually as a traditional craft in his childhood. And very few people actually use paper cutting to portray homoerotic themes, and Xi Yadie is one of the very few people who use traditional art forms to portray homoeroticism. And then the one on the right-hand side is an installation by artist Shi Tou and Ming Ming. So what they did was they posed in front of a frame and then took those pictures. The picture resembles a kind of New Year calendar from the earlier 20th century. In earlier 20th century China, there were, you know, a lot of coverage of female same-sex intimacy in popular magazines, etc. And people didn't take that actually so seriously. That was just part of the urban life. But of course, I mean, later history would change. So, and also we were talking about some artworks using new media forms, such as digital video art, as well as activist art, such as the use of performance art by China's feminist activists in protest of domestic violence, as well as earlier trans artist Ma Liuming or Fen Ma Liuming's work demonstrating the gender ambiguity. So all these very important work have been, well, have had very little coverage. And if they had any coverage, they were mostly confined to queer communities within China. So the first exhibition is called Biexing, or Difference Gender Exhibition, held in Beijing in 2008. So it wasn't called LGBT or queer exhibition. So the exhibition name is actually Difference Gender. So Difference Gender as another term for LGBTQ plus. So that exhibition, actually, I think on the first day, the police went to the exhibition and then examined the exhibition, and of course were not happy, asking the exhibition to be shut down. And then the curators negotiated with the police, and then some artworks, or actually most artworks, were taken off the exhibition, taken down, and some were preserved. So that was the first queer art exhibition inside China. And then this Pride 5 art exhibition was from 2018. And you can notice, you will notice that all the program is in English. This is because if they are publicized in Chinese, then they will get into trouble immediately. So all the publicity and all the, in a way, curatorial context is provided in English. So this is part of the Shanghai Pride. So these are situations within China, and I haven't actually discovered any more explicit queer branded exhibitions apart from those two. And then outside China, in 2012 and 13, Secret Love exhibition. Remember, it's not called LGBTQ plus exhibition. Its Secret Love exhibition was held in Sweden. It was probably the largest queer Chinese art exhibition held so far, but it had an Orientalist framing saying that this love can only be hidden in a kind of repressive society. And then Photosynthesis or Spectrosynthesis were in 2018 and 19 was held in Taipei and Bangkok. So that also assembled some queer art. And of course, I mean, the scope was wider. It, you know, included queer art from Hong Kong, Taiwan, Singapore, and other Southeast Asian context. So within Britain, there hasn't been an explicit queer Chinese art or queer EC art exhibition so far, but we see many endeavors or many projects. Some recent projects that I'm involved in include queer arts in the pandemic from last year. From last year, we showcases artists' work mostly online because of the pandemic environment. And then queering Chinatown, then making workshops. You might browse some of the zines at the back of this room when you have time after the book launch. So these were some zines made by community members themselves. I think some of our participants here also contributed their work. And then drag art project, which we're going to introduce in the second half of this book launch. So in a way, simple words to summarize survey is that, so within China and within Asia, actually the opportunities to exhibit queer art is very rare. And outside China, it is possible, but still actually, it hasn't actually become widely visible. So when I'm editing this book and tell people that I'm editing a book about queer Chinese art, and people ask, are there queer art in China? And of course, I mean, I can, you know, understand such reasoning, because I mean, there is such a kind of stereotype related to kind of how repressive Chinese society is. And even when you ask Chinese government officials, they will say there's no homosexuality in China. So, and then in recent years, the state media describe queer issues as Western influence or Western thing. It's not something that Chinese culture would have. So this is, of course, the background of this book. So this book, as a first, you know, a first book on the topic, aims to break such stereotypes, break such silences, to show visibility to queer Chinese artists all over the world. So we have two contributors from UK, me and Bu Rong, and there are other contributors from Germany, from USA, from China, from Hong Kong, and so on. So unfortunately, they cannot come today. We also have two editors, Jamie and DE. Jamie is based in Hong Kong, and DE is based in Zurich. So in a way, this is a kind of a transnational collaboration project, and we started with a book, with a workshop 2 years ago called Queering the Boundaries of the Arts in the Sinosphere, also an online workshop. Bu Rong was one of the speakers. And after that workshop, we felt that it's very important actually to document these artworks and art criticisms in the form of a book. So we contacted all the workshop contributors, asking them to contribute articles. And of course, some were able to contribute, and some, because of time or other reasons, couldn't contribute. So over 2 years, I think that as an editor, we have, in a way, harassed everybody with very strict deadlines and chasing everybody by email. Eventually, we have this book. So the book, in its current form, actually has 15 chapters written by 16 artists, curators, and academics. When people ask me whether this is an academic book or whether this is an art book, I would say it's both, because our contributors, some of them are academics like me and Bu Rong, and some are artists like Bu Rong and others. So Bu Rong is in the unique position of occupying actually both activist, artist, and curator, which is very good. But some of our chapters were written by artists based in China, and we had to translate their articles into English. And of course, the politics of translation is another difficult matter to navigate. But we are pleased that after working very hard with everybody for 2 years, and the book finally took its shape. So in editing this book, one of the questions we ask, which is also the title of the introduction, which is, what is queer about queer Chinese art? And of course, one can interpret queer in different ways. Queer can be a short form for LGBTQIA plus identities. Queer can also be a kind of anti-identitarian position. Queer can be a kind of political stance, among others. So what we find about queer Chinese art are the following. The first one is queer Chinese art does not have to center on LGBTQ plus identities. In fact, if you ask some of the contributors of the book whether their art is queer art or whether they are LGBTQ plus, and a lot of them would probably say no or not answer the question. There are different ways, different reasons why they would refuse to answer those questions. Well, simply actually, so it's difficult to come out in China, but that's one reason. Another reason might be that being queer, if you acknowledge you are a queer artist, then there are several some assumptions attached to that term, and not everyone is comfortable with those stereotypes and assumptions, etc. But this doesn't mean that their work does not have queer associations or have queer significance, because their work do actually tackle with issues such as gender fluidity and sexual diversity, among others. So we see queer more of a kind of subject matter, or also as a kind of reading position, rather than it's intrinsically about an artist's sexual and gender identity. And another interesting discovery about queer Chinese art is that queer Chinese art is not obsessed with what's Chinese or what's Asian, what's ESEA. So in the book review written by one of the anonymous reviewers, the reviewer has commented, what's Chinese about those artworks? Those artworks actually do not use Chinese ink painting, although some do. They are not using Peking opera or whatever. So why is that called Chinese art, etc.? So we would suggest that probably it's time to think about what Chineseness means actually to art and to everything. And then, of course, we are when we are talking about another criticism actually from the same reviewer is that this book is about. It is about different ways of expressions, but some are digital films, some are paper cutting, some are children's drawings, and yet others are installations, and others are, in a way, projects, activism, such as performance art. I mean, women marching on the streets, or people in Berlin, I think scientists here organized a queer of color, actually, a film project called Imagining Queer Bandung. And that reviewer also suggested that, is this called art? And so on. So of course, I mean, we acknowledge there are different ways to understand art, in particular in contemporary art. But we are suggesting that these should be seen as forms of art defined in different ways. So in this book, we try to actually capture different artists and activists and curators' voices, but we also try to create a queer archive. The book, if you have the book actually in your hand, you'll be delighted to find there are so many colorful images. So there are about 86 color images. So I know that we applied for some funding to subsidize the color printing, but you know, we are pleased that this book is printed in color, and we can, in a way, represent the artworks in more interesting ways than black and white pictures. So the book is divided into four parts. The first part is queering forms, materials, and traditions, in which we talk about actually how queerness can be related to, for example, the materials and the techniques of the artworks. So as a culture studies scholar, I was trained pretty much in textual analysis, looking at what's in the picture or what's in the artwork, not necessarily artwork as a form, as an object. in its material form. So it is through actually interacting and talking to artists that I started to appreciate those materials, textures, and effects, and so on. So that's the first part. So we have paper cutting, we have children's drawings, and we also have bondage, rope bondage. So in the second part, feminist interventions, we particularly put female artists with feminist consciousness as a, well, you know, in a central part of the picture. So we have mostly China-based queer feminist artists talking about their art practices. So the book cover with two people underwater is an artwork from China's first out lesbian artist Shi Tou. And then the next part is feminist queer and trans curation, in which we examine all those curatorial practices. So curation actually is often, in a way, neglected by critics, especially critics from a kind of textual tradition or from a kind of from artist studies tradition. But how you arrange works and how you interpret works is very important. So we have our curator Sihan's work introducing how he conceived the Secret Love exhibition in Stockholm about 10 years ago. And we also have Brian Curtin, an Irish writer, talking about spectral synthesis. So we are reviewing those two exhibitions and looking at their curatorial strategies and what kind of considerations are behind how artists are arranged, are labeled, and so on. And then we also have the first one written by Jie Te Li and Claire Ping, who organized queer women's art exhibition during the pandemic. So starting from 2021 and it's still ongoing. So they are actually bringing feminist art actually to art galleries and so on in a kind of more secret and discreet way, because feminism is currently a sensitive word in China. So you can't talk about feminist art, but there are other ways to introduce feminist artworks to the audience. And we also have the examination of Fen Ma Liu Ming, which is China's earliest trans artist, and how their work is interpreted in different ways in the past 20 to 30 years by curators and art exhibitions. The last part places contemporary queer Chinese art in a transnational diasporic context, and there's Bu Rong's chapter on her artworks, which Bu Rong will introduce in a minute. But there's also Berlin-based filmmaker Fan Puopuo, who created artworks or short videos and so on during the pandemic to address issues of queer identity, queer intimacy in the context of a pandemic. And the last one is an art project that Song participated, which is about a queer of color filmmaking and activist project also based in Berlin. So we hope that through those artists, curators, and activist reflections of their work, as well as academic theorization of their work, we hope to showcase the diversity of queer Chinese art. There's not one form of queer Chinese art. There are many, and not every one of them can be, in a way, delineated or defined clearly. So we thank all the contributors and all the editors and others. So I'll probably leave this to Bu Rong's and we thank Bu Rong, of course, as well. So I'll now invite Bu Rong to talk about her chapter on art practice. Thanks.
Thank you, Hongwei, for the very smooth transition into my work, and thank you everybody for coming to celebrate the book launch, and thank you for Hongwei for your like gorgeous description of me, but actually being an academic, being an artist, and also arts producer is kind of a quite difficult situation. Like, I just came from Edinburgh Fringe, actually, and we were talking about if you are creative as an artist, it's very hard to be financially smart as an art producer, but if you are financially money smart, it's very hard to be critical of selection of artworks as academic, as Hongwei. And if you're very critical, it's so hard to be creative as an artist. So that's just to explain me in this death trap of a trinity of the glorious artist, academic, and arts producer at the moment. So that's basically another introduction of myself and from the other side. And the title of my chapter is Too Much and Not Yet Enough. So when Hongwei invited me to kind of do a kind of description and genealogy of my life art and theater practice, I was thinking about my position. I was thinking about my relationship with queerness, particularly. So in the end, I choose this title, Too Much and Not Yet Enough, to frame my work as through the lens of intersection of neurodiversity, which I think myself as like this, not think like I am I am like neurodivergent practitioner, and also through the intersection of neurodiversity and the queer. And too much and not yet enough is actually like a paradoxical feeling that I find quite frequently, like in people with ADHD like myself, like you're constantly pushing yourself to do like different things, which already heard through my description. But I was thinking like the intersection between queerness and the neurodiversity, in particularly ADHD, and I found the commonalities, the excessive pleasure-seeking behaviors, because for people who might not know, like for people who have ADHD, it's actually a lack of dopamine in the brain, so that kind of drives me and loads of ADHDs to do the like pleasure-seeking stuff. Some are good, some are not. And I was thinking again for like a queer pleasure, queer pride, and there's also this like pleasure-seeking behaviors. Not like judging it as a, like from a moral perspective, but as a resistance, like in a, I think, pleasure-deprived society, especially in a, you know, like a neurotypical and a heterosexual nuclear family-oriented society, where I think the sacrifice of pleasure is such a common practice for so many people. And I'm thinking my relationship with queerness and with my illness, and also being a neurodivergent artist, that I find this as a common ground, as a lens to frame my work. And this is just some like introduction about neuroqueer, which I discussed this, that I just came back from Beijing. Like I was here for 6 months. I was like, I'm a neuroqueer artist. And people were like, what? Like, I realized neuroqueer. No, as you know, as normative as sounds to me, probably is not a common like, you know, like a curricular word for everybody else. So I just want to explain a little bit what neuroqueer means. So it's like a intersectionality of a neurodivergent and queer identities. And for neurodiversity, it usually includes like autism, ADHD, dyslexia, and dyspraxia, and all the other people who are not actually fit into the neurotypical society. And this is also just a short explanation of ADHD, kind of like dopamine-seeking behaviors. And I try to distinguish ADHD from the like hedonism as a philosophical approach, or as a, like magpie syndromes, because I'm so tired of people telling me everybody's ADHD these days. Like everybody's constantly seeking for pleasure, seeking for a next exciting feat. And I just want to say that it's very different from chasing, you know, like buying, especially in a consumer society, for the next shiny new things. Or it's kind of, you know, kind of a prioritized pleasure, because as I describe in the book, ADHD is actually, you're born with ADHD. So I think nowadays many people choose or deliberately, or you know, not deliberately, as a ADHD. But for me, it's just a kind of born with, and it's a born to. I call it like born to be a pleasure seeker, and that's just who I am. And that kind of put me into the, you know, this grand like a queer art world. And also, just want to add a little bit about what Hongwei just said. Like there are like 15 like
chapters.
Yeah, chapters like artists in the book, but actually the queer community in China is vast. Mm-hmm. Like even for the people I secretly interviewed or just having, you know, informal chats, and also the queer venues, pubs that I went. So it's actually a blooming of the queer thing at the moment, or underground in a way, of course, but actually it's coming up again. And yes, yeah, so that's just some background for the artists and venues and events that are not including this book, but it's already a very nice book as an introductory to the contemporary queer Chinese art. Okay, so the chapter I write include like three phases of my work, and this is just some. So I started as a playwright, and I had a device theater collective when I was in the uni, and these are some posters from the play I wrote before 2013, and in 2014 I went abroad to study, and the common thing. In this like a posters and other places that most of the character all the stories are deconstructive sad love stories in heterosexual society. and for me, I think from a playwright's perspective, I try to use gender neutral language, and also for all the shows I have cast A and cast B, not for, you know, commercial reasons, but to actually add a cross-gender performance into the show. So they are all love stories, right? Like deconstructive love stories. But like for the cast A, for instance, it will be a heterosexual couple, and for the cast B, it will be the like same-sex partner. But I don't actually distinguish, you know, the difference between them. It's exactly the same script, exactly the same story, same struggle, you know, for intimacy, friendship, on and on. But I just use cast A and cast B, and if people ask me, oh, is this, you know, like a same-sex story happening here? What's wrong with this? You didn't put it in the, you know, in the report when you ask for the performance permit. Then we'll just say it's cross-gender performance. I think some artists describe that as well in the book. So it's like a tradition in Peking opera where all the female characters are played by male. So yeah, so that's basically what I was doing as a, you know, as part of the traditional Chinese Peking opera. But that's just my way of, I think, situating myself in this like a queer works, if you like, is to use gender neutral language to discuss about relationship intimacy without really confronting or making distinguishment between the two. Afterwards, this is a second phrase, and because, sorry, like I'm very bad of documenting my own work, so I steal some works online, and it's called Aspy dossier. No idea, but I don't have pictures of my own work, so I just download it from the website. So that work actually, this is called Happening at the Very Moment. It's part of my MA graduate work for the Tisch at New York University. And this is because it was 2015 when I graduated, and that was also the same year when the same-sex marriage became legal in the US nationwide. So I just thought, if I want to get married once in my life, this is the time to do it as a political act. So, and also to get a good mark for my master's thesis. So this is the background, and this is actually exhibition which I realized in the Grassland Art District in Beijing in 2015. So for the exhibition, I basically asked people to marry with anybody or anything you like. So those are people actually marry with their phones, iPhones particularly. And you can see pictures that the same-sex couples. There's also more like polyamorous. So I remember there's one image which I don't have any anymore, have 10 people squeezing into that picture. And you kind of have to get married in order to see the rest of the exhibition, because that will be seen as an entrance ticket. So you have to get married. You can't be single. So yeah, I have people who marry with a tin of beer. It's also fine, as long as you agree to register and also have your photo taken with your partner or partners, then you will enter this exhibition through that full doors, full entrances. Then there's a ladder that you can climb. There's a mattress, a living, it's basically like a living room, and you have different ladders on the wall which you can climb, and you can make announcements, you can sleep there, you can have a beer in the fridge. And that exhibition went on for about 8 weeks. And that's me just doing some graffiti on the wall. That's also the last step for the exhibition. And you can leave your comments with some under some provocations I put there, like what if like a marriage institute of marriage ends, or what if the marriage doesn't exist between the two, but many more. So that's some of the provocations on the wall, and people leave their comments on the wall when they leave the exhibition. And this one, probably not very clear, it's just the door on the right-hand side, but it's actually the exit. So when people enter it, they just fall to the first floor. That's part of the second floor. You can choose, actually. I made it like more discreet before, but because there's so many shocks for the participants, and you know, so in the end, I just give them options. So many people just quite curious enter into them, just fall straight to the busy street in Grassland Art District. Of course, there's a mattress under it as well. So I guarantee there's no death. There's some injuries, but that's it. So that's part of the thing. I want to actually, I made this as an exit of suspicion to queer or to question if same-sex marriage is actually the best solution. So after all this, you know, celebrations, announcements, celebrating beer and everything, you fall to the reality of marriage that happens to same-sex couples as well as heterosexual couples. So that's just some thoughts on the, you know, to celebrate, but also to queer the legitimate same-sex marriage, and also to question if it's actually the best solution for countries that have not legitimized this. This is just some other works I did since 2017 as part of my PhD, like the doctoral research on stickiness in performance, which didn't realize in the end. So my thesis in the end is all about UK, like non-binary and woman artists working with sticky materials such as bodily fluids, eggs, and messy stuff like chocolate and honey. But this is just some like work in development, actually. That's like three personas I try to develop. So for the first column, it's just me in a wearable portable suitcase. And I did part of the Women of the World Festival for the South Bank. And I traveled with a suitcase on. So I was in the underground, I was in the Tate Modern. I got checked all the time, but once they opened the suitcase, because if you come from London, you know that they sorted, right? So I got, so I just tried to embody this seat. They sorted, and everybody just sealed the suitcase for me. So I felt quite happy with this portable, yeah, like a portable wear for myself. And it also used like some plastic dusty bags, kind of like trashy aesthetics for camp queer performance. And for the second column, that's my work with chewing gum. It's so bad for health, so I don't recommend you to do it. But I had this version for 3 hours and another version for 1.5 hours. So I'm gonna show you a video after this slide. It's for the Basno Green Working Men's Club, and me and the Korean artist Injun Kim. So we were chewing gum and try to produce sticky lines to make webs and wrap each other. that's a persona of a spider. Probably you can already identify this. So just a walkable, not just a suitcase on the street, a spider or hybrid creature. And the last one is me what's this about? It's actually, it's called double exploitation, but was inspired by a popular porn on Pornhub. It's like a woman got checked at the border control and got super excited with the checking process. So I just tried to find why and how to do this, especially for the camera. So I did this performance in a cabaret, a karaoke booth, part of the Chinese Us Now, which is now rebranded as Kakilang. And that's all the kind of ecstatic moments of me screaming very loudly after being checked thoroughly with a torch to my eyes, orifices, everything else. That's just some ideas which didn't actually come up as a show, but initially I want to do a solo show with three different personas. And that's just some ideas of how the stickiness comes from in my introduction. And yes, so I think this is a 1 minute video and just hope you can survive this. So it's at the Basno Green Working Man's Club, and it's such a nice thing to perform there for 1.5 hours with all the drunk working class men spitting beer on us. That's something not in the video. This is the last part. I know I'm running out of time, but this is a 7-day live stream performance I did for the between Christmas Day and the New Year's Eve in 2020. So for lockdown, Christmas and New Year. So I get a very small budget to do a performance project by the end of like 2020. And I just say if I die before December 31st, then I just get the money and get the money and run. But if I don't die, I'm gonna do 7 performances instead. So in the end, I did 7 performances in the end. And that's for me, it's a traditional breakfast show in a British culture, but probably you don't identify this as a breakfast show. And I did it between 10:15 to 10:30 a.m. every day, between December 25th to December 31st. And I discussed about different topics. So it includes like time, loss of taste, exercise, excessive shopping addiction, mukbang, which is kind of Korean culture that you eat excessive amount of food. And also I discussed about my family estrangement and my New Year resolution. So that's just my recent 7-day live stream practice. So that's it, and hope you enjoy it.
Thank you, Burong, for your wonderful introduction. So do we have time for Q&A? Sure. So let's pick up a few questions. If you have any questions, we'll be followed by the documentary, drag documentary. Questions? Okay. Yes, please.
Can you tell me, you are saying that in China people are closing down and shutting outlets for homosexual and gay venues, mm-hmm. etc.
NGOs particularly.
Yes.
And websites.
When do you not protest against that when you come to a place like Great Britain or America to join the pride? Because tomorrow is Pride.
We are joining the Pride, and this is one of the Pride events. So thanks very much for your suggestion. This is a great suggestion, but at the same time, it is not enough.
Yeah,
thank you for your suggestion. Any more questions? Oh, we can leave all the more questions to the end after we see the film, together with the film screening. Would that be a good idea. Yeah, shall we move on to the film screening? And then if I don't see any raising hands at the moment. Okay, great. So thanks very much.
Welcome back, everyone. So now we are entering the second part of tonight's event, which is a special screening of the documentary Drag Up. So briefly about the documentary, it is directed by Qianling Wang, who is also with us tonight. And in the film, we will follow seven young queer and Chinese identified people who signed up for a performance project in East London. And originated from this month-long community art project, they would learn about what is drag and how to perform it and discover their queer Chinese heritage and explore ways to de-westernize and decolonize drag. So following the screening, there will be a Q&A with the producer Hongwei and the project co-director Felicia Zhang and filmmaker Qianling Wang. So I'm going to briefly introduce Felicia and Qianling. Very quickly. So Felicia, or Felix Zhang, pronounced she, they, is a queer theatre maker and socially engaged art practitioner. The play they directed, Tana, was performed on Edinburgh Fringe in 2023. It tells the story of two queer Chinese students who cross the boundaries of gender, intimacy, and more. As a drag artist, their drag persona, quote, 404 now found, quote, embodies oppressed female figures in contemporary Chinese society and had her debut act, The Chained Bird, at the Royal Vauxhall Tavern in 2022. And then about Qianling Wang, pronounced she, her, is a queer filmmaker, community organizer, and recent graduate from University of Arts London, London College of Communication. She is passionate about using the camera to improve the visibility of marginalized communities. She directed the Drag Up documentary in 2023, which we're seeing tonight. And Qianling has been supporting the queer Chinese community through Queer China UK since 2020. And as mentioned briefly by Hongwei, they've done an amazing zine workshop. And you can see all their very nicely made zines at the back of the room, which is entering Easy Contemporary's collection as well. Yeah, so I'll hand over to Felicia.
Hello. Hi, I'm Felicia. I'm the co-director of the Drag Up project. Drag Up project was a participant-centered like workshop project for 4 weeks that happened in June this year. And we got a huge support from University of Nottingham, where Dr. Bao is. And we organize it in Queer China UK, which is a UK-based queer home community. Yeah, and this documentary is about why we want to do this and who were involved, why they wanted to be involved, what kind of story they want to tell, and how they did that. So we put so much effort into it, but we didn't feel tired or anything because we were so into it. It was such a nice experience. We feel so supported by each other. And hope you can enjoy the documentary and not noticing me in the corner feeling embarrassed seeing myself. Yeah, thank you for being here. And this is our director, Qianling.
Hi, hi, hi.
Do you want to say a few words?
Hi, I'm Qianling. Yeah, let's go straight to the screen.
Is it okay that we have a Q&A, of a shorter Q&A? Thanks very much. So thank everyone for staying for the Q&A. I know that we are running over time, but our host has kindly offered to have some spare time.
So if you have any questions, this will be time to ask the director as well as the filmmaker. And we also have two guests joining us. Wu Rong, you have already. And Hershen. Hershen is a researcher from Huddersfield University, and she is a queer researcher researching on Hong Kong Queer Film Festival. She was a researcher researching Hong Kong Queer Film Festival at Nottingham, I think last year or 2 years ago.
A couple years ago.
Thanks for joining us, Hershen.
My translator.
Yes, so great. So, do we have any immediate questions? Yeah, please.
So, I understand that the contest here is to explore Chinese queerness
through dragging up and also in relation to dragging up. So I can see that there's a backdrop here that is, you're doing this in the UK context, because obviously we're all here. And there is therefore an inevitable question of self-representation, how to represent oneself vis-a-vis the audience, vis-a-vis the people that you think will be watching, will be paying attention to you, however imaginary or real these people are. So I'm also thinking about this decolonial aspect of what you do. So how to decolonize oneself by self-representation in front of an audience that is, in this sense, culturally and racially different. How you negotiate this consciously and unconsciously, and also subconsciously. Can you please share? Thank you.
That's a great question. Can I invite Felix to answer this question?
Can you hear me? Yes. Practically what we did, we intentionally to put this project as a process-based project. So we had a very plenty of discussion and activities-based workshops to talk about this. We were not offering any answers, but we offer this space for the participants to ask themselves these questions. As you can see in documentary, I think one participant mentioned that, Ling Zhao, mentioned that her intention was not to prioritize the audience first. And also in Matt's act, because he found it cool. He wanted to create and present this act by spending time with the community and co-creating together. That's his kind of value. And for each participant, the value was different. And Mild Pearl, their act was more like a spoken word, more a speech. That's their values in the act, is that they wanted to engage the audience. They wanted to put a political stand in their act. So what I'm trying to say is it's very individualized, and we offer this space and opportunity to not put any censorship on what we want to do, not self-censor as well.
Yeah, thank you. Lin, do you want to answer this question?
Thank you.
Okay, so she agrees with what Felix said, so thanks very much. Okay, can we have the next question, please? Okay, again, please.
Sorry, I should have asked this second question altogether in the first place. So this is also about culture, but I want to ask about what you do in a wider context. If we zoom out and look at our UK context and context from elsewhere, how do you find people doing what you do but elsewhere? How do you, what are the nuances? What are the differences? You know, I'm thinking drinking up in US, I don't know, in Hong Kong, Taiwan, how do you see this movement?
Yeah, can I clarify actually? You're talking about drag art or drag cultures in Hong Kong, in other places, rather than drag up. So drag up is this kind of workshop.
Oh yeah, sorry. So I think what I'm asking is queer Chinese ness.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Still can ask Lin. Felix first. What's the cultural specificity of Chinese queer drag rather than English queer drag, let's say?
Okay, yeah. The reason we did it in London was because, for me personally, London already offered me some sort of diversity. I can meet different people compared to my previous base in my life stage. And then I think in the introduction of Professor Bao's new book mentioned that what exactly is Chineseness and what exactly is queerness. And in the project, through the workshops, through the discovery we made together, we think personal is political. How can you hold your own stand and then zoom out to somewhere else? But the first thing is to figure out what I want to stand for, who I am, how I want to be seen. That we sort of agreed on it, and everyone felt very comfortable and safe, relatively, to be themselves on stage. That's the first step before zooming out, have this condition and in a way privilege to travel around. Yeah, and also not all the participants were international students, Chinese students traveled to UK. There were British-born participants as well. There were migrants came to UK like 15 years ago. So it's really different from each other's case. And that was what I personally lack, allowing to be individual, allowing me to be myself back home. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Great. So in other words, I mean, there's no such overarching idea of so-called Chinese queer drag, which is completely different from, say, English queer drag, but rather it is about one's subjective experience and how one, in a way, articulate this kind of Chinese queer identity with their artistic and personal expressions. So, Blin.
Is Chinese, and my translation will translate my Chinese into the English. So Chinese queerness, right?
Yes.
And so, 中国的drag和西方文化的drag其实是比较，我感觉是完全不一样的东西吧。就是谈到drag的话，其实包老师也有之前在第一堂。 就是 workshop 的里面介绍中国的一些就是中国的戏剧文化，然后中国的戏剧文化其实在我们国内其实也算是一种就是不算是流行文化，但是也是 一种舞台表演的戏剧模式，然后大家就是会觉得在舞台上就是也算是一个 kind of 的一个明星，但是这种西方的主流 drag 和中国文化的 drag 其实是完全不一样的。Okay,
so from this, so according to what Blaine said, the drag in Chinese context is totally different from in the Western context, because in China we do have same doing theater performance on stage, but it's just totally different from in the Western context. And so, and it's also another kind of model of doing of the self expressions.
So kind of we call the drag in China called Beijing Opera, but we call drag in Western world. Drag is a name called that kind of thing. So it's totally different and. 去做drag表演，在国内的是在中国大陆，其实和在西方也是，我觉得是有些就是很大的不一样。在这边你可以自由的去表达你自己，或者是你想去做任何人，或者你想做这种表演形式，你想哪怕是有一个地下酒吧也好，你也有一个地方去做这种表演。但是其实在国内的话，如果你不是有这么一个的 群体告诉你的话，其实你是很难知道，就是我们可以去做这个表演，我们可以去做类似像西方主流文化的这种drag，哪怕或者是其他的，你可以做自己你想要做的表演。这两就是表演形式和表演的自由度，其实在这两个国家也是比较不一样的地方。这只是我是内陆发表内陆和在 UK 这边的看法，但是在美国和香港，我可能就不是很清楚。
Okay, well, yeah, try to record again. Blaine feels the huge difference between of doing drag, the way of doing drag, and also she feels the sense of the freedom of doing drag in the UK, and because there's this space, and also it's free. It's quite freely to choose what to perform and also how to perform drag. But in mainland China, there's if there's no support, community support, so the performers are really hard to find similar supports and don't really know where to perform, and so this is only Blaine's own feeling and experience between in mainland China and also UK context, and she doesn't really know not really clear about the experience in between the US and in Hong Kong.
That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. As you can see, that even our panelists don't agree with each other. They have different interpretations. Now, can we have a third opinion from Fu Rong?
Yeah, because I saw this for the first time, and it's nice to see like different faces, different expressions in this. So yeah, I was just wondering on the difference. I think for my work, for instance, I think it's just very UK context. I think context is everything. So I'm not finding any universal way of expressing myself, but it's really about the 3 hours waiting average time for the UK borders when you're getting as a foreigner, and it's about the say sorted such a not delicate way to say how to resolve a problem. So I think for me, I understand the strategy, of course, but I don't actually work with historical figures or mythological figures that kind of have a very long trajectory and a rich knowledge and culture background. I'm just
situate myself on the surface of the UK politics and the everyday struggle. I think that's probably the difference. That I think context everything, and if, because I studied in New York before, and I think the things I did there is so different as well. It's all about the struggle in the US and Latin American border control issues. So that's probably part of the ADHD as well, that you only try to find the sparkling, the pleasure of where you are at the moment. And for everything I was thinking is about the news from the UK perspective. And if I'm somewhere else, I'll make better performance. But I think for your work, it's actually more universal. I think if in the US, people also understand the struggle and some like representative issues or stereotypical or returning the gaze. I think that's all the things that people can understand outside the UK context.
Thank you for all your insights. It's great to know actually the importance of context as well as the importance of subject position. So your experience and your own subjectivity, your own political stance shape your own understandings of the issue. I hope that answered your question. I'm sure that we can only say there's no single answer to those questions. Sorry. Do we have any more questions? Yes, at the back.
No, I think I just want to add from personal experience, funding context give that context as well. Because like, let's say where I'm based in Germany, like many years ago, there was no this funding for process-based events. So you need to have a fixed performance exactly what to do to get the money. And the question going back sort of how did you argue with the funders and will this event series happen again, and you know, et cetera, et cetera.
Okay, well, I guess that this is a question for me actually as a producer of this project. I didn't actually even attend most of the workshops, so I guess for me actually in UK context, especially in UK higher education context, there is a space where academic research and community activism or art protection production can be combined, which is through the kind of bureaucratic mechanism of impact and KE or knowledge exchange. I'm sure a lot of my academic friends would say from at those terms, whenever I hear the term impact, I would say I would feel that is something actually that is really, really bureaucratic. But even for the most bureaucratic procedures can be used productively actually to help communities. In particular, if you see this impact not as, for example, being kind of policy makers, decision makers, usually in the past, and people think that arts and humanities people, what can we do? It's the social science people, it's the engineering, it's the doctor that make impact to the society. But in a way, if you think about actually, we work with communities and we make this society in a way a better place, a richer place, raising awareness of gender and sexual and race and ethnicity, cultural diversities, that is impact. Of course, there are formulas to fill, there are applications to be made, and of course, you have to fulfill certain whatever funders requirements. But in a way, actually, if you can put up with that, and if you can, in a way, navigate around that, there are still a lot of space actually to work with communities. And this project is funded by University of Nottingham's Arts Communities of Practice Fund. This is very new, and this project or this grant wasn't available last year or the year before, but since this year actually, somehow actually the universities that fund communities of practice can be a way actually for impact and KE. I hope that more researchers can make use of these opportunities. Of course, I mean, it depends on how you use it. But I'm not sure familiar with the Arts Council England landscape. So for such a project, for similar projects that you are working on, how would you get funding and how do you negotiate, for example, your own community needs, personal in a way, interests with funders' requirements?
Yeah.
Can I turn to Bu Rong?
Yeah, so I think, well, I can't speak. I think on the, yeah, at least on the surface for us Council England at the moment, it's all about EDI, right? Like inclusivity, diversity, and equality. So that's EDI. But in terms of, you know, like how they actually put it into practice, that's a completely different story. So that's one of the first thoughts. And second thought is very interesting that Hongwei mentioned about community, because I think for us councils, let's create strategies for the next 10 years. It's all about community building. So from the shows I saw at Edinburgh, there's so many jokes about, you know, the limitation of arts and artists. And I saw like a poetry work, and it just says on the poet, like, this poet can change the, you know, the equality, and it can make people richer, and it can make only cats gain 10% of government funding by looking at this beautiful poet. Another way to mention, I think community building is very important, but also have some kind of surface, you know, kind of doubts about the limitation of arts and how, you know, how many boxes we can take for the people from the high end. And if they don't make any changes, like grassroots actions actually don't mean a thing. We're just doing more heavy lifting works for them. So community works definitely matter. But also I think the people from the high up need to make some changes as well, not just the artists.
Yeah, I completely agree. So Felix, do you have anything to share? You have done a theatre project, and how did you get funding for that project?
Oh, for my theatre project, my mom funded
me. Yeah, that's a class war now.
And if I want to fund myself, or, well, one thing, I have to make this theatre play into a community project in order to get art capital funds, or I just make it commercial and keep acting. So I just did 19 shows in Edgefringe, and the audience, in total, the audience came to my show was less than here. So, thanks, Mom.
Yeah, that's it's very great to have a good and supportive mother. And can I ask you, Lin, as well? So basically, for this film, the production process is actually was very low budget. And how do you manage the low budget production? And what were some of the challenges that you have encountered in making the film? 我翻译一下，就是说你的这个制作还是比较低成本的。那么，尽管是我们有一些钱，但这些钱绝对是不够制作一部影片的。如果像样的，像那样制作一部影片，像是《 Paris is Burning》那样的影片的话，你的像我们这个经费是做不到的。你是怎么样在这样有限的条件之下，然后创作出来这部纪录片的？
Think you talk about，就是发挥人的主观能动性，把你身边所有能利用起来的资源都利用起来。就比如说我们的资金比较紧张，我们租不了好的设备，然后其实，像片中其实声音其实也是一个很大的问题。像我这个声音的问题，就是因为我当时没有钱买麦克风。然后所以我当时就是用手机和相机自带的录音系统，但是后来发现其实还是不太好，但是这个片反正就做完了。然后这是录音的事，还有相机的事情。相机是因为我自己本身就有，但是其实一个机位去做这个录制这个 workshop， 我其实还是有一些就是吃力，还是需要就是有人和时间，还有就是有这个专业的知识能去帮忙。但是其实我们是没有钱去雇佣这样的人，所以我们就只能招志愿者，就是看谁有时间和能过来。我们都不要求就是他有专业的知识，就是他只要会开机关机就可以了，然后剩下的就是他能帮我们看的就行。所以在资源和资金比较仅限，就是有限的情况下，其实就是想办法利用自己身边的资源吧。没有相机用手机，没有录音用手机，反正现在有手机基本能解决所有的一切。对，质量不敢保证，但有东西总好过没东西。
Okay. Yeah. Blaine said, try to use all the resources we can use, and I think there's the issues about the equipment and the cost of buying microphone was quite high, and that was quite high at the time. And so she just used phone or the phone, the camera. But unfortunately, the sound quality isn't always good and clear. And also, it lacks the funding, and it lacks the funding to hire the experts to help the filming. And so they can just rely on volunteers to do some limited help. But the summary is, cell phone saved the film.
Great, thank everyone for sharing your inspirations, both of kind of tenacity, working with difficulties, but also actually some opportunities, I mean, how to explore different opportunities. I hope that answered your question, Sant. So I'm aware of the time, and we are being, I think there's still some drinks and some food over there, which I should encourage everybody to take. And also, if you have individual questions, you're welcome to come to our artists and filmmakers here. So I was wondering if the host has any announcements.
No, we don't have any further announcements.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for our speakers coming today.
Yeah.
And really, I think it was really meaningful to talk today, and really something that we have to talk about, and appreciate for everything. And also, thank you for guests who stayed up until this late and very patient with us, and also for all this help and also supports for the city inventory. As how Dr. Hongwei mentioned, we still have some refreshments over there, feel free, and do mingle, and just let us know if you have any feedback through our EC Contemporary website, and safe trip home. Thank you very much.